Hi, welcome to my Embedded Linux Conference Europe talk about U-boot, porting and maintaining a bootloader for a multimedia SoC family. So who am I? I'm a kernel and firmware hacker for the last 14 years. I ported Linux on custom SoCs because I was working with the SoC design team. I'm a Baylibre engineer, a company in South of France for the last 5 years, and among other projects, I write support for the AMLogic Mail and Linux support and U-boot support. For the last 2.5 years, I'm the custodian maintainer, which is a SOC tree for AMLogic U-boot. And I did, for example, 47 pull requests since January 2019. I will speak about maintaining the AMLogic U-boot, mainline U-boot. So AMLogic provides a set of line of multimedia SoCs for the last few years. Originally, they designed very low cost digital TV set-top box SoCs you could buy on Chinese market, for example. They did the first single board computer that AMLogic helped to produce it, called the Ojoid C1. It had quite some success. And the following board, the Ojoid C2, became quite famous along the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi is more famous, but the Ojoid C2 is still a standard right now. Quite old, but still a standard. So it's a quad Cortex A33. It has USB 2, Ethernet, Gigabit, HDMI 2, eMMC, pluggable eMMC, SD card, the standard Raspberry Pi current pin header, and it had 2 gigabit of DDR. So this was 4 years ago. So 4 years later, this is a new Ojoid N2 Plus, which uses a brand new AMLogic SoC, which still has 2 Cortex A33 plus 4 Cortex A73 with USB 3, HDMI 2.1, and 4 gigs of DDR. So it's much better. The board is much better well done. The first Ojoid C2 had power issues. Everything has been solved on this new Ojoid N2 Plus, and you have a Ojoid C4 alternative, which has the same form factor as Ojoid C2, with the same Cortex A55, but without the A73 cores. So, what does AMLogic provide? So, they provide an open source vendor kernel tree in their BSP release. They are not no more accessible on their Open Linux tree, but the vendors like Artkernel for Droid or CADAS for the CADAS Vim boards provide them. So at the time, 4 years ago, it was 3.14 for the Ojoid C2, which is really old. And for the Ojoid N2 Plus, they base their code on the 4.9 kernel. So, what is the state of the code? So, yeah, they don't follow the kernel frameworks at all. They didn't follow at all. They had a clock driver, not used by the drivers. But since we were paid to do some upstreaming, and they reuse some drivers like the PWM, but they still heavily change them, so it's sad. But finally, I saw in the last 4.19 kernel that the device tree is finally correctly architectured. All their display multimedia code is completely custom. It doesn't follow any standard. And nothing is really usable actually. It's why everything is rewritten to be upstreamed. The DT was completely custom. They didn't separate correctly between the SoC DT, DTSI, and the board DT. The compatibles were funky. So it was hard to understand for newcomers, contributors, that the vendor DOS3 could not be used at all with Mellon kernel. They also provide the U-boot, which is part of their boot chain, their secure boot chain for digital TV set-top box. So until recently, it was based on the 2015.01, which is really, really old, and then mixed match some recent code and some very old code, because at this time it was only the beginning of the device driver model. So it's really a melting pot of very old driver model code and really new driver model U-class. It's really hard to follow. They have the completely custom EMC partition in U-boot, in Linux, doesn't follow anything standard. They have their multi-DT selection, completely custom. And all their multimedia or their graphic drivers are completely custom, doesn't follow anything. To flash a device, they use the same protocol between the boot ROM, which is a USB gadget protocol. The boot ROM supports the USB boot, but it's not a USB boot like other SoCs. Doesn't go and read on the USB flash. No, it's a USB gadget, so it provides a custom protocol. And it's the same, based on the same protocol between the ROM and their U-boot. So if you are curious, I wrote a tool called PyML Boot, which is used to boot a SoC in USB gadget mode, which is a fallback boot mode. So when you have no boot target, so no SD card, no MMC, it will use this protocol. So I wrote a Python tool to use it, and really, really handy. It's notably used by, the Libre Computer Lafrit to flash the U-boot code in the SPI. So it's really handy to have, I never implemented it yet under Mellon U-boot. So, as you can understand, the drivers on the vendor U-boot are not reusable at all. So, they have now a recent still 2 years old base U-boot that supports only new SoCs. So, all the SoCs are not supported. It's still too old. And in fact, when you dig, it's absolutely the same code as before. They only move some bits in the right place, but it's not usable for a maintainer code base, and not usable to upstream some drivers. So, what is the boot flow of this SoC? So, since the new ARM V8 chip, which is the S905, they use TFI or ITF, PSEI to communicate with the TFI binaries, and SCPI to communicate with the coprocessor, the SCP coprocessor. So they used it because the ARM said it was mandatory. And before, they used a complete custom bootflow with an ARC coprocessor. But yeah, it was similar in concept. But it didn't follow any standard TFI now defines. So for the TFI boot chain, the boot ROM does the BL1 stage, and they provide the binaries only for the rest of the boot chain. For example, the BL2, which is where you initialize the DDR. It's a binary. The BL13, they added this stage because it's a binary they load in the SCP coprocessor. The famous BL31, which is the runtime firmware that replies to PSCI calls, the PL32, which is a secure payload, usually you load opt in it, and you can build some bits from their U-boot tree, which is, for example, the ACS binary, which is a DDR controller settings, so which is embedded in the PL2 binary. The BL21, which also is embedded in the BL2 binary, it's a board specific power unit, because AMGIC does not use only use some PWM regulators on the board for power management, so you need some code to actually set them. And you also have the BL301, which is a loadable part in the SCP firmware, where you handle all the syspan resume and the resume source, for example. So which is great is the binaries they provide are the same as product uses to have a full secure scrambled boot. They use the same chain, but the issue is that all the secure boot flow is not documented at all for non-AMGIC customers. So what is the upstream status of the ARMv8 SoC, so the first S905 on the ODOT-C2 to the latest A311D, which is the same as the one on the Android N2 Plus. So we have a really great Linux coverage of the system. Because U-boot use the driver model, we have a quite U-boot coverage as well. We have a partial TFI upstream, only the PL31 stage, because all the other stages are very complex to reverse engineer. Especially the BL2, which has a really complex DDR init code. Not sure it will be able one day to do this without proper documentation. Maybe one day, hopefully. And yeah, we will need documentation to do a clean job, especially on the secure memory map, which is unknown. So, for the Linux coverage, you can see my other talk about this. I did a few talks this last year to explain. So if you don't want to see them, too lazy to watch them. So globally, the basic system support is complete. We have MVP basic, including DVFS. We have suspend support for the last SoCs. The first ones are not possible. We have basic IO support complete, with SPI, I2C, etc. What is partially supported is multimedia. We lack all the advanced digital TV features like HDR, conversion between planes, 3D support, dynamic HDR and so on. It's not supported. We have no support at all for video encoders. So we could support the H.264 encoder. But for example, the HEVC encoder is separate IP, and they provide a user space binary for that, so you need advanced reverse engineering to port it. And we support partially the video decoder. We support basic H.264, VP9, and we have HEVC support, but of 3. So if you have one more status on Linux support, you can go on the linux-mason.com website. So for U-boot, we also have a great coverage because thanks to the U-boot driver model, we can port very simply the Linux drivers and simplify them in U-boot. So same, we have the system support which is complete. Everything basic IO is supported, UART pin control, code control, PWM is now supported, reset, Ethernet, PSCI, Fuse, SPI, I2C. Advanced I/O is partial or Ethernet is okay. Still need some work. USB is okay. We have OTG support for all the supported SoCs now. SDMMC is supported. We lack NAND support. We have the driver Linux, but we still lack NAND support. PCIe support is missing to have NVMe boot. For video output, we support HDMI output in boot, which is great. The DSI, MIPI DSI support is ongoing along the Linux support. So we support every single board computer on MLogic SoCs, we know, except the only ARM v7-1, the Android C1. We don't support, even under Linux, we lack video support for this generation. The only single board computer we don't have is the Banana Pi BPI M5. So we are waiting for sample, but as I saw, it seems to be almost a clone of the Android C4. So nothing spectacular. We support generic reference design. So MLogic historically for each SoC package variant, they did a reference design, which was possible for vendors to take as is and do a product very quickly. So for example, for the S905, it was the P200, the S905X, the P212, for example. So you can presume every Chinese set-top box is based on one of these reference design, and you should boot directly Linux. And I won't say U-boot because it's much more complex for U-boot, but it should support any generic board if you have the right TFI binaries and DDR settings. So the U-boot driver model helped a lot. It would not have been possible without it. So the NAND driver is missing, but the Linux driver exists actually. So it's only a matter of porting. The PCI driver doesn't exist, but Linux support PCI Express. It's a matter of porting, but have a hard look. It's much more complex because all the Synopsys PCI Express controller hasn't been clearly cleaned to have a common support. So for the few tweaks are still needed. For example, for the Ethernet PHY, we still have a static configuration. To support, I have either the internal or the external PHY. We have a mux to use either the internal bus or external bus. So we have a driver on Linux. U-boot now supports everything. They support the PHY mux, but we don't have the driver, so we need to write it. So HDMI support is supported. HDMI output is supported. The display framework is really simple, like every U-boot U class, but it works fine. It does the job. We have implemented MIPI DSI output on U-boot. It's a matter of pushing it correctly. The only problem is the edit parser on U-boot, which is really primitive. Let's say in the edit, you will have a bit field for standard and established timings. So, for example, all the VESA standards, you have a bit for each standard. You have detailed timings, which is you encode directly the timings in the edit. And you have a table, for example, for HDMI VIC, which is a number, a standard number for each, for example, for 1080p, that's 720p, for example. The problem is U-boot only takes the detailed timings. So it completely ignores the time standards, the established timings, and the VIC timings, because it doesn't embed the timing tables. Because in Linux, for example, you have huge tables to translate the edit in a set of timings. So Ubuntu doesn't have that. So we support only the extraction of detailed timings. So on monitors, for example, usually you put you have four detailed timings slots. You always put your native timing of the monitor in one of the slots. But if some case is not the case, for example, you always also put a fallback timing like a VESA timing. But some monitors don't do that. So if they didn't put a fallback timing with low, small timing, you won't have any display at all. So we cannot support 4K in Ubuntu because of that. So it's a work to do someday. So what is really great with Melian Ubuntu is UEFI support, which is basically come from free, because it's a default setting. So it's a great motivation to have the upstream support maintained, because you get all the new UEFI support for free. So you can directly boot Ubuntu installer, the SUSE installer, the Debian installer on Almogic SBCs, which is really great. With a simple RNG driver, we support Linux KSLR boot through UEFI boot. But we still miss runtime variables. So runtime variables are from Linux the possibility to update the UEFI uboot variables for the next boot, for example, for the boot order, for example. So this needs runtime code from uboot still running when Linux is booted, and it implies this code can go and write on a Spinor, on a EEPROM. So we still need to have an onboard storage like a Spinor, and say Linux to not touch this device, or find a way to handle it between Ubuntu and Linux. So which is good, and we use Ubuntu, Melian Ubuntu is used in a real product. So for example, you can see, maybe you know Lafrite, which is done by Libre Computer. It is a really great and low-cost board, really basic. We have a simple USB, Ethernet, HDMI, and the 40 pin. And the particularity is that it use the bootloader used on this product is Melian Ubuntu exclusively. So the guy who owns the Libre Computer did a great job into adding some dynamic menu to enable flashing and so on. But it's still completely Melian Ubuntu, which is really great. And it leverage all our effort and job you can do a real product based on that. So how it's done the upstream development? So the initial support of the Almogic SoCs in Ubuntu was done by Beniamino Galvani. Really, thank you. He also did some of the initial Linux drivers as well. We have only a few non-Belieber quantum computers, which is sad. So the Ubuntu process is really close to Linux. So you pass to the list, you wait for reviews, and the maintainer takes the patch and push them to the project maintainer, which is Tom Rini. So the issue is you have really a few reviewers, not a lot. So when you have non-core patches that doesn't touch other platform, they are less or not reviewed. So it's not a problem to take them and push them directly. So what is great, because Ubuntu is quite small, they have a handy test suite which is called Sandbox, based on Sandbox. Sandbox is a U-boot platform which runs as a Linux application. So you can run it as a standard process, and you can communicate with all other Linux processes, so you can coordinate tests from Python. And this is used in the CI, which is run at each U-boot commit upstream. So it's a great way to check if there are no regressions. So an issue is that on ARM Logic SoCs, you need to package U-boot in the TFI boot chain. So you need absolutely the complete boot chain to be able to run U-boot than Linux. ARM developed format file for storing all the boot chain called FIP. Amagic used it at the beginning for the first SoC called JGPB for S905. But afterwards, because they have a lot of binaries, a lot of firmwares, they decided to create their own format, their own headers, and so on. And the last SoC, they have like 10 DDR initialization firmwares loaded in the BL2, so it's complex. The issue is all the packaging tools are closed source, and the packaging process is not documented. We need to look at the U-boot vendor tree makefile to look at what is called. So this is an example of packaging, which is pretty ugly. So you have some tools in a Python shell and a closed source. When you pass the input binaries, and you get an output, a set of output binaries from the final call. And this final u.bin binary is in fact the full set of binaries used by the bootrom to boot the device. So these tools has been reverse engineered actually. So initially it was Andreas Ferber that did the initial reverse engineering. He added the S95X support in these Maven tools. Repka did the JXL tools reverse engineering, and recently the same was done on the new generation SoCs, G12A, G12B, and SM1 binaries. Because these new tools has you can compress in LZ4, for example, and they have advanced signing, for example. So this is a schema of the signing. So in blue, you have all the binaries. All the full open source binaries, okay. So including the bash script, yeah, it's open source because you can compile it. In red, you have the closed source binaries, and in green, you have the fully upstream binaries, and in the mixed green red, you have the binaries and tools that are both. Either have the AMLogic full closed source binaries, and you have an open source equivalent. So you see, they take a lot of binaries and mix them and synthesize them and then package them in the complete binary. So the issue with that is you mix in the same final binary some closed source stuff, some GPL stuff, and in the beginning you had no license terms to distribute the binaries at all. Finally, they added a license term recently, which is much better. For the ACS BL21 et BL301, they are part of the vendor U-boot source, so historically we assumed it was GPLv2. Recently they added the header, so they are GPLv2. For the BL301, Binary, it's not clear because some headers has a GPLv2, some not. So maybe eventually. So these three binaries, we could move them out of underyoboot in a separate repository, but where? Maybe in the mainline yoboot? I don't know. Not clear enough. So this is a recently added binary distribution license for the BL2, BL31 and BL32 binaries. So it's a classic distribution binary license. But yeah, it's clearly says you need a permission to redistribute them. So it's unclear what are the legal issues into redistributing these libraries. So this came about the license terms. So everything is green, or all the green is GPLv2, so open source, or you have the right to rebuild and redistribute. The red need to follow the MGK binary license terms. And the mix of colors is ever you have need to follow the MGK terms if you use the binaries, or you can have a GPLv2 implementation which is available. So, as I said, we have a partial support for the BL31 support in a TFA upstream. So the S95 is the first NVMe8 SoC. Which has issues. For example, the crypto acceleration was broken, and so they also had some flaws in the boot ROM. For example, you have the well-known bypass of the secure boot was were able to dump the boot ROM. The TFI support is partial. We don't support spun resume, and we don't support secure boot. We never tested it, so maybe we support it. It's not clear. For the second generation, the third generation of the SoCs, the accelerators works now, which is great. We still don't support spun resume. We didn't still don't know if secure boot works, and we don't support the S9912 variant, which is the one with a second cluster of Cortex A53. So we need to find out how they managed to enable the second cluster in order to support this SoC. So for the AXG family, which is an audio application variant based on the previous SoCs, it's the same support as other SoCs. And finally, for the last generation of SoCs, which is the kind of modern SoCs, so it's an S95X2, S95X3, and the last one. The support is the same as before, except we don't support the latest SoC variant, the G12B, which has a second Cortex A73 cluster. And we still don't support yet the SM1, which is the one with Cortex A55 cores instead of 53. But this one is only a matter of adding a flag. So should be easy to support. So, on the secure boot subject, so this SoC was designed in mind for secure boot product. They are used in secure product using Android TV, and they are fully certified, white van, etc. So, if you want a real world secure boot, it's really complex. Honestly, you can't imagine the constraints on the secure boot validation. So, because of that, all the tools are private, closed source, and completely undocumented. The issues map is not documented at all. And beware if you want to fuse your SoC, you could break the device quite easily. But even that, we don't have the programming sequence of the fuse. And anywhere, we will only need a trusted boot, which is really a boot with a certificate. to have a secure boot using standard the standard upstream BL43. For example, we could implement UEFI. We can use UEFI secure boot to have a trusted boot will be enough for that. So we will need unified open source tools to generate the binary. Today we have three different tools. So we instead of creating a new tool to replace all the other tools, we have three different tools with different names instead of using the vendor binaries that are binaries, but it's unified for the case. It would be great to have full open source TFA, including the BL2 and the secure processor, but this is complex and not sure it will happen one day. For U-boot support, we miss NAND, PCI Express. We lack the old ARM v7 SoCs, we could be great to have. And we lack the EFI runtime variable, which will be a great addition to have a seamless boot of EFI. We lack testing. Now we have a lot of boards supported, and they are not tested at each release. We wait on feedback of people using them, but it's not enough. We plan to set up a true CI to boot test them on each vendor U-boot commits, but it's not the case. It still needs to be done. We have everything to do it, but it needs to be done. So, it's the end. If you have a question, don't hesitate to ask. Thank you. Bye bye.